morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome, welcome to Harmony Springs. Welcome back. Welcome for the first time. Welcome, welcome. If you're here, welcome. As usual, a couple things to announce to get us started, some housekeeping things to keep things moving along smoothly for you and for I today. First of all, as usual, you can follow along with the service at harmonysprings.org/online. You can pull out your cell phone, bring up the order of service today, follow along. You can't cross things out like I used to as a kid on the bulletin as you go, or fill in, did anybody else fill in the zeros or the O's, do that activity? No? Okay, just me? All right, well, you can't do any of that. You have to do, unless you know how to do it digitally, which I'm sure some people know how to do, so. There you go, you can download that. Click on Church Connect underneath. You should be able to. Sometimes I forget to put the right information in for you to check in to let us know you're here today, but you should be able to click on the I'm here icon on Church Connect and put in your name and let us know you're here today. We certainly appreciate that. There are our order of services also on there, and also links to, you know, YouTube and watching previous services, that kind of thing. If you missed any of the last 3 weeks of Jim Bain, Reverend Jim Bain preaching and stories from Camp Christian, they were all super great, so you can look those up on our YouTube channel. Just, you know, put in the search bar Harmony Springs and you'll find us. Welcome to all of our friends and family who are online joining us today. The Benjamins, of course. Benjamins, I'm sorry we haven't had that much snow for you to fly away from, but either way, the beach pictures you show me are great. So last week I jokingly said that Debbie keeps sending me beach pictures, and I tell her to go ahead and stop sending me all those beach pictures. But you know, I don't mind it anymore now. We're getting close enough to the end of the month and into March that I'll take all the beach pictures you got. So there we go. Welcome to our friends online. You can, of course, follow along as well on the website. You're already there if you're joining us online. And we participate in communion and receive communion here every Sunday. If you're at home joining us or watching on YouTube after the service is over, grab some bread and juice from your fridge and cupboard, and you can participate with us, along with us, in your own space and own home. All right. Let's get started this morning. Well, we've been doing some sing-alongs, some easy sort of songs to sing together as we get started. And today is the first Sunday of Lent, believe it or not. We have these Sundays leading up to Palm Sunday and Easter that prepare us for the Easter season. Today, I want to invite you to stand and join in singing a well-known one that we love here. They will know we are Christians by our love. Will you stand and join in singing with us? Just a few minutes ago, but Today is the first Sunday in the season in the church that we call, do you know what it is? What did I say it was? Lent. Lent. Do you know what Lent is? It's where we eat a lot of fish. We go to fish fries on every Friday. In the Catholic Church, they're not supposed to eat meat, right? So on Fridays they do fish fries to help. They're not supposed to eat, you know, that kind of meat. But fish is okay, I guess. So that's why there's so many fish fries. But here at Harmony Springs, these are the Sundays we also acknowledge Lent as the season before Easter. Easter is, of course, when we get all those Easter eggs and candy, right? Yes, I was just at the store yesterday, and they just replaced the Valentine's Day candy with Easter candy, right? So all those peeps are tempting me and all those crazy flavors they make now. But, so in the first beginning of Lent, we do this crazy thing. I didn't even turn it on, Mr. Landon. We do this crazy thing that we're going to let people come forward when they come for communion. I have this one. We take ashes. Are you all listening? This is crazy. We take ashes and people put them on their foreheads in the shape of a cross. Is that crazy? Why do you think they do that? Do you know? Any reason? Yeah, it's kind of weird, isn't it? Yeah. Well, we put it in the shape of a cross because Jesus died on the cross, right? And the cross is a symbol of Jesus. And we do ashes. We take the palm branches from the year before and we burn them. Somebody burns them and turns them into ash. And then we mix them with a little bit of solution that I can never quite get right. And then we put them on our forehead. And if the pastor mixes them right, they stay on your forehead. If he doesn't, like I usually do, they just drip down our faces and it gets real messy and real crazy. But so today, to make sure that we don't get all crazy with it, we're going to have people come up when they come up to take communion. And Pastor Kim and I are going to, I practiced it myself. Can you see all the ash in my hand? We're going to let people hold out their hands and we're going to put a cross on their hands. And when we do that, usually the pastors or priests say something like, they quote a scripture verse from Genesis, which is where this all comes from. And in Genesis it says, from ash you came, and to ash you shall return. Which is pretty deep, I know, for you all. But let me break it down this way for you. We put ash on our hands and foreheads to remind us that life is short and we gotta live a full life as best we can every single day. Does that sound like something you can remember? All right, so do you all want me to make a cross on your hands? All right, so you gotta make a fist and hold them out like this. All right, and then I'll put it on and I say, from dust you came, and to dust you shall return. I don't know, that one looks more like an X, but. From dust you came, the shower chair. That one was good. Alright. Do you guys want a cross on your hand? Come on over. Okay. From dust you came, to dust you shall return. Loving and gracious God, thank you for the reminder that we have to live every day to the fullest. Thank you for the reminder that you've created us and that we are yours throughout our lives, that you look out for us and care for us. And we pray for each of these children's lives, that you might bless them in the days and years to come. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
On this first Sunday in Lent, we continue to remember Pastor Joel's words, ashes to ashes and dust to dust. As we lift up our congregation, please remember to pray for one another as we continue to pray for the world. And as we try to let you know that we're available for prayer, and let us know your prayer requests and whatever's going on in your life, we want to know. Let us pray. Lord, on this first Sunday of Lent, we remember desert things and dusty things. We ask you, God, to continue to create clean hearts in us that we may even glance upon your purity. We know that your goodness is beyond our understanding, but we're grateful for it. We thank you for your love and your watchful eyes. You're always amazing us with your kindness, Lord. Lord, we would ask that you would guide us in a way that is to go for us, for your will and way, for the children, and for all of us. We need your guidance. Help us to not go astray in our thoughts or our intentions. Help us to continue in the path of righteousness. Lord, as you guide us, we also ask to be strengthened in this holy season, to be strengthened to nurture others, to help others and even ourselves, knowing that there are people right here, right now in pain. As we pray for those and those around us and those around the world in pain, Lord, with nowhere to turn, we ask your great strength to abide with all of us. And Lord, as you teach us, we would like for you to teach us your heart, teach us your will and way. As you have told us, you are the way, the truth, and the life. As we pray, Lord, against racism, against intolerance, teach us, Lord. Again, create in us clean hearts. As we ask you, Lord, to be a people triumphant, as we know that we do lean on you for guidance, for strength, and to teach us. We pray for the world in need, from California, Lord, to East Palestine. We ask your help in Turkey and surrounding the world, Lord, with your loving, gentle arms. Embrace us as we continue our worship, as we live our lives. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and our Jesus who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thine will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we continue with the word from Matthew chapter 6, 16 through 18, we do pray for Pastor Joel as he comes to bring us the message today, as we pray for Emily and the entire family. Hear the word. When you go without eating, don't try to look gloomy as those show-offs do when they go without eating. I can assure you that they already have their reward. Instead, comb your hair, wash your face, then others won't know you are going without eating. But your Father sees what is done in private, and he will reward you. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Fill me with life anew.
Good morning. First of all, let me start with an apology. Usually that's a good way to start, right? This season of Lent, I have decided to use this new devotional book called Unsettling Lent that some fellow disciples, pastors, and professors have put out, and I ordered them, and they are sitting in my garage. Totally intended to, I should know by now that I should not try to remember to bring things on Sunday to church. Gotta bring them a different day. So we do have them for you, but unfortunately you probably won't be able to pick them up in person until next Sunday, but that's all right. We got plenty of Sundays to get our stuff together before we hit Easter. So you will be able to do that. But as an intro, let me just say that this unsettling Lent is our theme for the next few weeks leading up to Easter. And I want to thank Pastor Kim for being willing to kind of help me with this theme over the next few weeks. You've heard from a few different pastors in the series, three-week series or so far this year. So you've been waiting, I think, so hard to hear me. You've just been breathlessly, right, waiting for me. So you get this Sunday, and then Emily and I have to go to Austin, Texas to Emily's cousin's wedding. So Pastor Kim will be helping move this series along next Sunday. And also on Palm Sunday, Debbie Benjamin just sent me another picture of the beach while I was sitting here. I'm collecting them now because we're going to Bermuda as a family on our kids' spring break, which is the week right before Easter. So Pastor Kim will be preaching on Palm Sunday as well. So you get a little bit of both of us over the next few weeks is what I'm trying to say. And I think it'll be great. And I tell you what, I went years being here because whenever I was gone, Pastor Kim would fill in. And when things weren't recorded, I never got a chance to hear her. And then the last time she preached, I got a chance, we were on vacation, but I could just call in and listen to it, and I heard her whole sermon, and holy cow, she's way better than I am at preaching. So you'll definitely want to be here next week to hear her, and again on Palm Sunday. You shake your head, but all right. Unsettling Lent, the theme, and let me throw this out for you as we get started on this series over the next few weeks in this season of Lent. Unsettling Lent, the whole devotional book and this whole idea, which I hope we will take some time to read these daily devotionals. Lent, of course, is a season that is 47 days long. This gets complicated in the church because it's... We don't count Sundays because Sundays during Lent are like resurrection Sundays and celebrations, right? So we get like 40 days plus 7 for Lent. I'm not very good at math, but somehow it all works out and gets us to Easter. So there's that many daily devotionals that are about one page long. So it's not hard to participate, not hard to do it. And I've picked out a few that have been meaningful to me as I sort of read through them, and I'm going to preach on that. Yes, Glenn, what questions? I'll take questions, sure.
Well, I just happened to do a Google search, and Unsettling Lent, the first 7 lessons are available through Google Books for free. So if anyone wants to digitally participate this week.
Thank you. I meant to say that as well. You can order. In fact, I've sent it to a few people. The Kindle version is... The book is $4.99, so it's not an expensive book for sure, but you can order the Kindle version as well. So. You should be able to follow along. If not, I'm planning on posting some quotes from each one on our social medias over the next few days as well. So we'll get ourselves the snowball effect rolling here, and we'll get ourselves into the Lenten routine. So that being said, I've picked out a few of these daily devotionals to focus on Sundays as we move forward together. And then, I don't know, if you've been paying attention, if not, that's totally fine, but we have a group of like a dozen or so folks who have been meeting over the last few weeks, and last Sunday heard a presentation from Dwayne Krabs from South Street Ministries about their work dealing with violence and gun violence in Akron. And we will have on March 26th, also the Sunday before Pastor Kim preaches, we will have a guest speaker who is also a disciples pastor, an ordained disciples pastor, Chris Eggert, who is the founder of an organization based out of Cleveland called God Before Guns. And If you're picking up on the sort of theme here, if I had to break it down, it is simply this. The church for a long time, and there's nothing wrong with this, has looked at Lent as sort of an individual spiritual practice. It's, you know, we give up chocolate or social media or then, you know, we have these different themes that sort of come about. People for a while, people were saying, well, instead of giving something up, let's add something to our routine, or let's just, you know, be nice and kind and treat people nicely, which I don't think it takes Lent to get, you know, make us do that, or shouldn't take Lent to make us do that. But regardless, this idea is that Lent also has a sort of corporate or community component that we ought to examine and look at as we follow Jesus's journey into Jerusalem and Palm Sunday parade and Easter, his death and resurrection. As we look through those stories that are leading up to those events, as we prepare ourselves, there is also a sort of social and community and corporate part of Lent. Or at least there can be, or should be. So why would we invite somebody to come in and talk about gun violence and social activism? Because as we read the stories of Jesus, that's what Jesus was doing. He was organizing people. He was creating a movement of change in the world he lived in then and calls us to do the same. So that's a number of these devotionals are coming from that perspective, that Lent and Christianity is certainly deeply individual and spiritual, but it is also a practice that we can all look at and engage in together, and we should look at Lent and the life of Jesus with that sort of wider lens to understand how Jesus, in his journey to the cross and resurrection, calls us to participate in big change and movements in the world for change. Does that all make sense? Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's where we're going. If I had to lay it out for you to get started. Today, of course, is the Sunday after the beginning of Lent, is Ash Wednesday, which I referenced with the kids. We have, over the last few years, participated or offered a bestowing of ashes on Ash Wednesday. This year, we thought we would invite you to receive ashes today as the beginning of this Lenten journey together. So when we come and invite you to come to the communion table, if you would like to receive ashes on your hand, Pastor Kim and I will have them up here, and we can certainly bestow those ashes to help mark the beginning of this journey together. All right. A lot of things to cover since I haven't been up here for the last few weeks, right? Today I'm wearing my Cleveland Guardians baseball shirt because spring training has begun. Right? If you happen to watch them. But in the back of my head, I'm looking forward to spring training and opening day and going to baseball games. But currently, I've been enjoying watching our other Cleveland sports team that's playing right now, the Cleveland Cavaliers, mm-hmm. right? And I was thinking about that this week, the difference between, now some people, you know, baseball is America's pastime, right? We love to go to baseball games. We love to be social and to spend three, if there's extra innings, 4, 5 hours at the ballpark or whatever, right? The thing about baseball games, which makes that game unique, is that there's no clock. Right? It's just innings, 9 innings. But if it's tied at the end of 9 innings, you just keep playing inning after inning after inning. Now, of course, Major League Baseball last season wants to speed things along, so they start with a runner on second if it goes into extra innings to kind of get the ball rolling, right? Because otherwise the innings can go on and on and on. But basketball is totally different. Basketball and football and other games have a clock that runs. Depending on the game, you know, if there's a foul or the ball goes out of bounds, like in football, you know, having watched this, the clock stops for a period of time, but then it starts again. And as I've been watching the Cleveland Cavaliers and listening to, I share the same opinion as Austin Carr and some of the other announcers that what the Cavs actually have been struggling with this year, although they are way ahead of where they could be with such a young team, they are exciting to watch, but what they've been struggling with is playing 100% full-on basketball for all four quarters. For a while, they got behind in the first quarter. In fact, they sort of have the habit of doing that, of letting the other team really get ahead in the first quarter and then slowly catch up. The other day, the Cavs were behind by, I think it was like 32 points in the second quarter. And you know what? In the past, watching the Cavs, I would have turned the game off then. But now I watch the Cavs and I know they're going to chip away at that, the second quarter, the third quarter. They're going to get better and better. And then somehow Donovan Mitchell decides in the fourth quarter to like really play his game. And before you know it, they've brought the score within 5 points, two possessions, or tied it, or sometimes pull ahead. Why am I talking about basketball? Well, there are a lot of life baseball analogies, but probably the biggest one in life is that just like basketball in games that have a clock, they start and they stop at a set time, that's how life is. Life starts and stops. The truth is, none of us are getting out of this alive. Right? We might want to go into extra innings and keep going, but honestly, that is out of our control. We've all probably lived life long enough to know that life can be tragic, and we lose people too soon and too often. When I start talking about death, we all just get sort of quiet, don't we? It's not easy to talk about. In fact, in our Western American mindset, we would much rather push the reality of death way to the side and not even look at it or acknowledge it. I was listening to a radio interview with an ER doctor who recently wrote a book and worked in an ER in New York City during the COVID pandemic. And I don't know if you realize this, but I did not, but 3,500 doctors and nurses lost their lives during the COVID pandemic, just trying to help people. He wrote the book as a sort of way of dealing with all of the trauma and I would say PTSD that he has actually experienced and that those who worked in the healthcare field went through and experienced. And in the book and in this interview, he tells a story, reflects on how doctors and nurses and those involved in the medical field deal with death. In the interview, as he described it, I realized that doctors and nurses really don't know how to deal with death any better or any more than any of the rest of us. In fact, in the interview, in the book, he says that when somebody who came into the ER, often they're not somebody that you have a relationship with, even a sort of medical relationship, because in an ER emergency situation, you're just there and they're trying to save your life and get you stable, right? And a lot of times, especially during COVID and with everything else going on, not everybody made it through, like none of us will, right? And so this ER doctor was saying that the ritual of, if you've ever watched any medical show, right, when somebody passes or dies, what do? They call the time of death, right? 3:07, time of death. And then as he described it in the interview, all of those gathered in the room to help keep somebody alive just sort of look at each other awkwardly for a little while. Because the patient that they were working on and working together on was no longer there and present. And he describes it as sort of this awkwardness that medical professionals aren't really quite sure what to do with, because there is something meaningful that happens in that moment. Someone's life has just been lost. That person, whether they, however well they knew them or didn't know them, probably had loved ones or people that then needed to be contacted or people that would, that either loved them or they loved in return. And the doctors and nurses all would just sort of look at each other and then leave. And the way he described it, there wasn't really any ritual or process to confront death or to deal with the fact that we all will and do die at some point. In the interview, he said that actually one of his medical students at some juncture during the COVID pandemic came up with a suggestion. And even though the medical students aren't, they're supposed to be there to just learn and not really speak and do too much, but this medical student, after a time of death was pronounced on a patient, spoke up and said to those gathered in the room, "Would you just take 30 seconds with me in a moment of silence to acknowledge that this person's life, the fullness of this person's life, and the fact that it has been lost, and that people who love them have their hearts broken, et cetera, et cetera." And they started participating in that ritual of just taking 30 seconds, giving thanks for a life, the person that laid before them, and acknowledging the fragileness of life in that moment. I grew up in a more evangelical church, and I didn't grow up in a church that did Ash Wednesday until a friend of mine who was Catholic invited me to her church on an Ash Wednesday. And if you're not Catholic and you go to a Catholic Mass, it can be a little overwhelming. There's a lot of things to know and do. You have to kneel at the right time and say the right things. But I didn't let that try to bother me, right? I was just there to sort of observe and to be a part. And you can participate in a Ash Wednesday Mass even if you're not Catholic and haven't gone through the Catholic ritual or the training and classes and membership, et cetera, et cetera. And so I went forward with my friend and received ashes from the priest on my forehead. And I think there was a homily that was similar to what you might hear on an Ash Wednesday homily about how life is short and we all come from dust and we all will eventually return to dust, the famous quote from Genesis 3:19, right? From that point on, I think I was hooked on the practice of Ash Wednesday because it is important, I think, for us, especially in our Western American mindset, to acknowledge and to realize that simple truth, that we are all human, that none of us will make it out alive, and that we must, I think, it's an important reminder for us to live our lives as full as we possibly can, the way Jesus calls us and wants us to live every single quarter of our lives, giving 100% as much as we possibly can. I know there are times in life where we're just exhausted and we've experienced trauma and we all went through COVID. I know that there are times in life where we just have to take a deep breath, but Jesus says to us, and the gospel says to us, and the scriptures say to us, you came from dust and you're gonna return to dust. The time clock is running and the end is going to come. So let's give every quarter what it's due in our lives. Maybe it's a good sports analogy, maybe it's not, but I keep watching the Cavs hoping and praying that they will find a way to not get behind and to keep up with the other team. When you can do that, you can win ball games over and over and over again. So here's what I'm left with on this Ash Wednesday and this reminder, or Ash Sunday, I guess, and this reminder of our own mortality that the Lenten season and Ash Wednesday makes us confront and face. I guess I'm left with this as it comes to, when it comes to this unsettling Lent and our sort of corporate good. here's what I come back to, is if all of our lives are finite and none of us are making it out alive, then what is left for us to spend our lives doing? What does Jesus want us to spend our lives doing? And I'll tell you what, if Jesus is organizing a movement to cultivate hope and love in our communities for good, to leave a lasting impression and legacy in our world, I think that's where we got to spend 100% of our energy, listening to Jesus calling us to organize and to change the world in the limited time that we have here, so that our kids and the next generation can do the same, and maybe we'll leave this world a little bit better than we found it. It's not an easy thing to do. It definitely takes us digging deep and being on more often than we might like to. I know all this is really serious, so I wanted to lighten the mood a little bit with this. Do you remember back in 2016, there was a YouTube video that went viral? There was an interview with a woman in Oklahoma City that had just experienced an apartment fire. Her name was Sweet Brown. Okay, all right, we remember, all right. There's a phrase that I probably utter it to our kids like once a week or something, I don't know, because they're always asking me for stuff and I just look at them and I say, ain't nobody got time for that. If you haven't seen the video, I brought it along to show you. Jim's gonna show
you. One resident describes her horrifying experience when she first realized the complex was on fire.
Well, I woke up to go give me a cold pop. Then I thought somebody was barbecuing. I said, oh Lord Jesus, it's a fire. Then I ran out, I didn't grab no shoes or nothing, Jesus. I ran for my life. And then the smoke got me, I got bronchitis. Ain't nobody got time for that.
According to the apartment manager, the...
Ain't nobody got time for that. So I don't know, here's what I was thinking. Hopefully this may be something. I know you probably, from week to week, you probably don't remember much of what I say, but something about that phrase I've remembered since 2016, right? So if I had to break it down, I guess I would say this, like, you know, life has a beginning and an end here on earth. And there are things that we could spend our time and our lives doing. We could worry about what other people think about us and trying to please people and trying to make sure that everybody's happy with us, but Lord Jesus, ain't nobody got time for that. When it comes to church, we could be concerned about things like the color of the carpet or the drapes, etc., etc., what the pastor is wearing or not wearing on any given day, but Lord Jesus, ain't nobody got time for that. Think in your own life, the things that have consumed you, that when you look backwards in time, you can say, I shouldn't have given that a minute. Shouldn't have given that any sort of acknowledgement. Because Lord Jesus, ain't nobody got time for that. We recently just watched Super Bowl commercials, right? In the Christian community, the He Gets Us campaign has been controversial at the least, right? A group of Christians spent $14 million to try to make sure Jesus needed or wanted to rebrand Jesus, to make sure that people realized that Jesus was all the things that we are, and that Jesus wanted social change. And I love the message, but Lord Jesus, spending $14 million to put that on TV, ain't nobody got time for that. But spending $14 million to house some homeless people or start some community gardens, or if they're listening to this, Harmony Springs would love to have some money. You know, I wish and I pray that Jesus didn't need rebranded. I wish that Jesus' followers would just do what Jesus had said. It's not really that complicated, right? They'll know we are Christians by our love. If we just loved more people and housed more people and fed more people and organized more and tried to make sure that we advocated for less guns on our streets and violence and more peace, etc., etc., I think then we'd be doing the work of Jesus and Jesus wouldn't need rebranded in the first place, right? Yeah. I wish we didn't have to spend our time, or they didn't have to spend their money doing that. Because ain't nobody got time for that. Amen?
Thank you, Pastor Joel. I think this is Mark, isn't it?
Yeah. As speaking of, you got time for that. I don't know if you heard already this morning about the Dilbert cartoon. As we think about Black History Month, the Dilbert cartoon's been removed from some papers and even the Cleveland Plain Dealer because the cartoonist said that Black people are a hate group. Nobody time for that, Pastor Joel. And then just a couple days ago, I was listening to a synopsis on a Halle Bailey, who is taking the part of Little Mermaid. Doesn't that sound sweet and innocent? Little Ariel? And she said that when she was first cast, she got so much hate and racism, mail and posts. She said that she can no longer read the comments. That's now. I mean, that's not, we're not speaking 20, 30 years ago illustrations. That's now. And so hopefully and prayerfully we can continue our prayers and our work in the kingdom for each inning that we have to try to eliminate racism, and bigotry, and hate. Jesus was all about love and mercy and kindness. And as we remember our Lord in this Lenten season, we remember that in the night that he was betrayed, he gave thanks and gave bread, took the bread and gave it to the disciples saying, "This is my body given for you, as he said, do in remembrance of me."
In the same way, after dinner, Christ took a cup and poured it out for his disciples, reminded them, as Christ does us, that as often as we drink of this cup and eat of this bread, we do so in remembrance of Christ. In a few moments, when we invite you to come forward and to receive the bread and the juice, the symbolic elements that remind us of Christ's sacrifice and resurrection in our own lives, today we also want to invite you to extend your hand, and if you wish to do so, and Pastor Kim and I will place a cross that is ash to remind us that life is finite and that we have to live every day 100% to the fullest, and that Jesus offers us the sustaining grace to do so every day of our lives. The gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to him.
Will you join me in prayer? Lord, outwardly we need to be unsettled. We need radical love and passionate patience to deal with the world and to be able to do what you need us to do and to be who you need us to be. But inwardly, we need a steady center, a place for our hearts to recalibrate, a place to refocus. Your table provides this. It is the spiritual quiet zone that allows us to recharge, to reboot our goals, and to get rid of all of the extra white noise that surrounds us. So thank you for the bread, the wine, the sacrifice, and the time to do that. Thank you for this solid base that comes from your table and from the sacrifice you made for us. Thank you for the opportunity to work your magic of faith. Amen.
My friends, the table is set and all are welcome. Would you come? Take heed and be blessed if you haven't already. Few things to let you know about as we bring things to a close this morning. Some announcements that you may want to be a part of. I want to highlight again an opportunity you have to buy a share in our Harmony Grows Community Garden out here. We've sold a number of shares already, and if you would like to be a shareholder, you can. You can go to our website to read about it or to the Harmony Grows website. It's harmonygrows.org/CSA. Sorry. You can, a part of that, I think it's $360, and I'm having trouble swallowing again. Jeez, Jesus. Ain't nobody got time for that. Christy, our garden manager, will produce your share of the produce that grows there from the end of May through October. So it's a great way to buy healthy, locally grown produce and to use it at home. You pay up front to help support the cost of the garden and the plants and the tilling and all of that, et cetera, et cetera. And then you get to enjoy all of that produce over the next few weeks during the summer and into fall. So take a look at that if you're interested in being a shareholder in our community garden out here. As well, another quick reminder, if you're elder or trustee, we're gonna have a brief meeting right after service today. So stick around for that. Do we want to give an update? I was thinking, do you want to give an update on the total amount that we raised on the cake fundraiser? Are we?
$1,000 exactly. At the last minute, I received a donation from someone for $6 to be able to help us over that.
Hey, all right. There we go. Oh, very good. So all of that, those funds are going to the mutual aid fund, which we manage here at Harmony Springs to give to folks who are in need that get referred to us from a number of places, but lately mostly from guidance counselors at the schools. When they have a family who they hear about who is in need, they can contact us through a simple form, and then we reach out to them and find out what's going on, try to offer our support and help, and then follow it up with a $500 gift to them as well to try to help in whatever their financial straits and situation may be. All right. Mads, if you're friends with Mads on Facebook or Instagram, I've been seeing a lot of pictures of Dahlia, and I want to invite her to come up and give us an update on how it went in Indiana.
Thanks, Derek. Got my own musical introduction. It's nice.
Yeah.
No, so as you can see, obviously I do not have Dahlia with me at the moment, or Karen. They're at home right now. It's going to be a couple Sundays before Dahlia is able to come with us. And that's just because she needs to settle in and figure out her new routine, and we need to work together a little bit more as a team before we're solid enough to be around large groups of people. If you don't have an Instagram or haven't followed along on Facebook, we did pass our public access test, which is super exciting. I was kind of nervous about it. So that basically means that we're certified to be in public places, and we are an actual service dog team. So thank you for all of your support in helping us get there. It's been pretty amazing. I just wanted to give a few pointers, and I'll let you guys know the Sunday before when we're going to bring her. But if you have kiddos that you want to help explain the do's and don'ts of what to do around a service dog, there is a great book available on Amazon or through Instagram to their shop called Dogs with Jobs by Natalie Lenski. And it kind of explains the difference between a pet, a police dog, a service dog, a guide dog, and kind of explains like what they are and aren't allowed to do around them. But for all of you adults in the room, a little short stint about that is that when she is here, she is working, which means no petting, no talking to her, avoid eye contact if you can. It's going to be really hard, I know, because you guys have been a huge part of this journey and want to meet her and love on her. But the best thing you can do for her when she's working is ignore her, because she adores people. And I'm sure that if you were to come over to our house, then you would be able to interact with her a little bit more like a normal dog, because that's her safe space where I know she'll listen and she gets to kind of like be a little bit more free to do what she wants. But yeah, so when you do see us here, if you can do your best to ignore her and remind your kiddos that she has a job and that she's not just a normal pet and her job is to focus on me and make sure that I'm okay. That would be fantastic. We'll probably be sitting in the back here along this wall just so she's not distracted when everyone gets up for communion or for worship and such. But yeah, we're so excited to bring her around and let you guys meet her. And if you want to see more pictures, I have them on my phone. So come find me. I love talking about her. Thank you.
Very good. Well, hopefully today wasn't too unsettling to you, but if it was, may it be beneficial in your week and life to come. And may the face of God shine upon us as we journey through this unsettling Lenten season. Amen? Amen. Ain't nobody got time for that.
Describes her horrifying experience when she first realized the complex was on fire.
I got bronchitis. Ain't nobody got time for that. Ain't nobody got time for that. Ain't nobody got time for that. Ain't nobody got time. Ain't nobody got time. Ain't nobody got time for that. Ain't nobody got time for that. Ain't nobody got time for that. Ain't nobody got time. Ain't nobody got time. Ain't nobody got time for that. Ain't nobody got time for that. Ain't nobody got time for that. Ain't nobody got time. Ain't nobody got time. Ain't nobody got time for that. Well, I woke up to go give me a cold pop. Then I thought somebody was barbecuing. I said, oh, Lord Jesus.